Hi, and welcome to day 28 of our 30-day at-home retreat. We are at the near end of the retreat, and we are celebrating the later days of the fourth week when we rejoice and relish the days of the resurrection. Today, I invite you to pray over the beautiful gospel story, John 21, 15 to 23. John 21, 15 to 23. Let us begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And he said to them, "Feed my lambs." He then said to him a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And he said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to Peter, "Tend my sheep." Jesus said to Simon Peter a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was distressed that he had said a third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Amen, amen, I say to you, when you were younger, you used to dress yourself and go where you wanted. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go." He said this, signifying by what kind of death he would glorify God. And when he had said this, he said to him, "Follow me." Peter turned and saw the disciple following whom Jesus loved, the one who had also reclined upon his chest during the supper. Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, what about him?" And Jesus said, "What if I want him to remain until I come? What concern is it of yours? You follow me." Amen. Today, I encourage you to pray over the theme of mission, your mission from the resurrected Christ. During the second week, we prayed over the life of Christ, but we also prayed in a sort of parallel way about the theme of discipleship. I encourage us to do the same today, that we pray over the resurrection of Jesus, but also pray over the parallel idea of discipleship, about mission. What is our mission based on our experience of the risen Christ? Do you notice this beautiful scene where Jesus says to Simon Peter, "Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me?" And Peter says, "You know that I love you. You know that I love you." This is oftentimes referred to as Peter's first confession, if you will, that Peter had to go to confession. He had to go and become, if you will, absolved of his sin. Not so much for Jesus' sake, but for Peter to sort of receive the recovery that he needed in order to become the disciple that Christ was calling him to be. And that's beautiful and a beautiful, tender thing to reflect on. But I also invite you to notice how Jesus says, "Peter, do you love me? Then go feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Then go feed my lambs." There's this urgency there that Jesus grammatically doesn't want these two phrases to be outside of one sentence. He wants these two things to be together. If you love me, then you must feed my sheep. These things go together. They cannot be separated. And Jesus is trying to point that out to Peter. Yes, he's trying to heal Peter of his emotional wounds, of his psychological wounds from Peter's own terrible misstep of denying Christ. Yes, he's healing Peter, and he heals Peter because he loves Peter, and that's the whole reason he came, was to forgive us of our sins. But I think he's also wanting Peter to be a missionary. He wants Peter to be a strong disciple of himself, of Christ. He wants him to be an ambassador of the risen Lord. And Jesus knows that this won't happen until Peter's soul is clean, until he's healed, so that he can move forward. A wounded warrior is not going to be a very effective warrior, or a runner with a rock in his shoe is not going to run very far or very fast. And so Jesus sets out, if you will, to remove the rock from Peter's shoe so that he can run. But Jesus is trying to say that these two things go together. Do you love me? Then go feed my sheep. That you cannot do one without the other. That you and I, we do in fact have, let's say, an exclusive relationship with Jesus, but only to an extent. Because if I really do love Jesus, the authentic Jesus, this relationship is going to burst forth. It's going to burst forth and lead us to ministry, to bringing others to the resurrected Lord. It is inevitable. That's just an inevitable thing that happens from having an intimate relationship with Jesus. It's what the Trinity did, right? Remember that we looked at the incarnation, at the Trinity looking down at the earth, and the Trinity saying, we must go to them. There's an urgency, and there's a sort of demand that love makes, that we must go to them in love. Well, this same demand is here, that this demand that love makes even on the Trinity to go to the people of the world through the incarnation, this same demand Jesus is making on Peter. Do you love me, Peter? Then go feed my sheep. Go feed my lambs. And notice that the very next line, Jesus says that, you know, when you were a young man, you could go where you wanted. You could walk where you wanted. You could dress the way you wanted. And then Jesus says, but you know, as you get to be an older man, others will dress you. People will bind you, and others will dress you, and you will go where you do not want to go. Of course, John's gospel points out that this is referring to the martyrdom of Peter. No doubt about that. But I wonder also if maybe Jesus is trying to make a statement to Peter about, Peter, you don't have a choice here. If you're going to love me, then you must go and be a missionary. And why would he say this? Why would this be important? Because Peter was off fishing, huh? Peter was confused. He wasn't sure what was going on with this whole idea of the resurrection. And so what does he do? I'm going fishing, he says. And thank goodness his fellow disciples jump in the boat with him, and they're able to recognize Jesus on the shore, and they go back. But this is the point, that Peter seems to want to go back to his old life, to his past life. Remember, in John's gospel, every word is meaningful. Every image has a sort of almost a double image, a double meaning. And so Peter is saying, I'm going fishing. What he's telling you is that I'm returning to my old life. My old life as a fisherman. So when Jesus says, you know, Peter, when you were a young man, you can go where you wanted and do what you want. But now that you're an older man, you're compelled. You're compelled. Later on, it'll mean binding and martyrdom. But right now, what's binding Peter is actually love, as a matter of fact. His love for Jesus compels him to go to the missions, even if Peter is more comfortable in the boat, which of course he is, right? You and I, when we feel confused, when we feel lonely, when we feel nervous, when we feel frightened, we want to go back to what's familiar, go back to the past, the things that are familiar to us. This is what Peter was doing. Jesus is saying, those days are over for you. You don't go backwards. You don't go back in the past. Now you are compelled by love to go forth and feed my lambs, feed my sheep. You notice that Peter, he's in the boat, and John, of course, says, it is the Lord. And what does it say Peter does? And again, remember, John's gospel, every word is important. So it says that when Peter heard that it was the Lord on the seashore, Peter put on some clothes and jumped in the water. Now, isn't that a strange thing? When you and I, when we go to the swimming pool or we go to the beach, we usually go dressed in a lot of clothes, a few layers, and then when we're ready to jump in the water, we take off our shirt or whatever, and we just go sort of scantily clad, so to speak, in our bathing suit. So you remove clothing to jump in the water. And that certainly would be true for the Israelites as well. But the gospel says that Peter put on clothes. He put on clothes before he jumped in the water. What's happening here? It could be, maybe this one interpretation would be that Peter had the dress of the fisherman. Remember, he's returning to his old profession. He's giving up on his discipleship. I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm not going to take on that role anymore. I'm going to, my mantle, the mantle that Christ has given me as an apostle, as a disciple, as a missionary, I've taken that off. I don't have that anymore. And now I'm wearing the outfit of a fisherman. A fisherman in Israel would have just worn a very small, sort of skimpy loincloth. And what John is trying to say is once Peter recognizes Jesus, he immediately puts on what? He puts on his robe of a disciple. He puts his mantle, if you will, back on. And then he jumps in the water. And notice what he's doing. He's abandoning the boat. He's abandoning his fish. He's abandoning his nets. He had already long ago, immediately they left their nets and followed Jesus, it says in the call of Peter very early on. But here, Peter went back. He backstepped. Now he's putting back on. He's remembering who he is. He's now a missionary. And what does Jesus say? Jesus says, "No, Peter, it's not fish, it's sheep. You're not going after fish anymore. You're going after sheep. You're going after sheep." So I think this whole thing is, of course, Jesus healing Peter and reconciling with Peter because they are intimate friends, huh? And Jesus, of course, is the Savior, of course. But I think there's also a sending forth here, a missioning that's happening. And Jesus telling Peter, you no longer have the luxury of going back to your old life. That's not an option for you anymore. You keep that mantle on. You keep the robe of the disciple, the missionary, on. And then what happens? Jesus seems to, it doesn't say it explicitly, but he seems to stand up and he says, "Follow me." And he seems to be starting to walk away. They're having this beautiful fish fry on the shore. The picnic blanket spread, right? And all of the fish and the food and the drink and everything's laid out and people are sunbathing. And all of a sudden, Jesus says, "Follow me." And he gets up and he starts to walk. And everybody's scrambling. They're putting away the paper towels and the picnic basket and folding the picnic blanket. They're trying to scramble to meet Jesus again. And what does Peter say? Peter looks over at the one whom Jesus loved, presumably John, and says, "What about him, Lord? What about him? What's going to happen to him?" And Jesus says, "Don't worry about him. That's none of your beeswax. What if I want him to have a whole different mission? You follow me." And then he seems to walk on, and they have to catch up to Jesus. A couple of things here. First, they're having to catch up to Jesus. Jesus is always a bit ahead, and so we're always having to catch up. Jesus wants us to keep up, and he's urging us on. There's an urgency here because we have a mission to do. And Jesus also says about John, he says to Peter, he says, "That's none of your beeswax. Don't worry about that, Peter. Your mission is to follow me into discipleship, into the mission, to be my ambassador of hope." So let's put it all together now. Jesus seems to be saying, you can't go back to the past, right? Peter, no longer going back to the past. You can't go back to your old profession, your old ways. You have to stay a disciple. You have to go where you do not want to go and be dressed in this other dress that perhaps you are uncomfortable with still, because it's the dress of a missionary that I'm sending you out on. Also, there's no self-loathing, right? He doesn't allow Peter to self-loathe, so he takes him to confession, give him absolution. He does this to heal him, but he does it to get Peter to get over himself so that he can go and be a good missionary, a good and strong missionary. Next, he doesn't let Peter compare himself to others. Don't worry about other people. I want you to follow me. Keep your eyes on me. Don't look to the side and look at this person or that person. And finally, and this one might surprise you the most, In a way, you could say Jesus is also saying no exclusive Jesus and me relationship. Of course, we do have an exclusive relationship with Jesus. We do have an intimate one-on-one relationship with Jesus. We belong to Jesus and Jesus belongs to us in this sort of exclusive bond. But is it really exclusive in the end? No. As I said before, it's always bursting out. And so they're not going to sit on the seashore for very long. Jesus has this intimate moment, this quiet moment, this peaceful moment, just Jesus and me. But then he stands up all of a sudden and says, let's go forward. And they all have to follow along. We're not going to sit and just sing songs by the campfire. We have work to do. So what is all of this about you and me? We are celebrating the resurrection. And like St. Peter and the others, we can sit on the seashore and enjoy this quiet, intimate moment with Jesus, the resurrected Jesus. But we're also going to hear Jesus prod us forward. We're going to have Jesus tell us to get over our self-loathing, to get ourselves reconciled with God in whatever way that takes, to let go of the past, stop resorting back to things that are comfortable from the past, to stop comparing ourselves to others. And even ultimately, we do our prayer with Jesus alone in our room, and then we stand up and go do the missionary work. We are on day 28, so perhaps Jesus is telling that to you and me, that we've been having these wonderful 30 days of silence and prayer, of quiet and peace, a little bit exclusive, a little bit intimate with Jesus. And meanwhile, for most of us, this COVID crisis has us locked up in our rooms, in our houses. But now things are, at least for now, are starting to open up again in the world. Maybe Jesus is pushing you and me to open up as well, to stand up from the seashore, this intimate time we've had with Jesus these 30 days. Now Jesus wants to compel us outward to the world where we can feed our sheep. Let us close, as we always do, with our scripture passage. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, then feed my lambs. He said to Simon Peter a second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And Peter said, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, tend my sheep. Jesus said a third time to Simon, son of John, do you love me? And Peter was distressed that he had said to him a third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. So Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Amen, amen, I say to you, when you were younger, you used to dress yourself and go where you wanted, but when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. He said this to signify what kind of death he would glorify God. And when he had said this, Jesus said, follow me. Peter turned and saw the disciple following whom Jesus loved, the one who had also reclined upon his chest during the supper. And he asked, Master, what about him? And Jesus said, what if I want him to remain until I come? What concern is it of yours? You follow me. Amen.